God, the highest king, wields a sword of judgment by which he will save those who trust him. And Isaiah's book and ministry center around one moment in Isaiah's life where he actually encountered this king's divinity. Isaiah saw God Almighty seated on a throne while heavenly beings cried, "Holy, holy, holy." And as Isaiah saw the enthroned Lord of hosts glistening strong and pristine, Isaiah heaped woes upon himself, for he knew he must perish for what he had seen. For he and his people were untrusting. And it seemed Isaiah was correct to predict the destruction of his soul. For like a sword of judgment, one of the heavenly beings carried from the heavenly altar's flaming bowl a holy burning coal with which he would touch Isaiah's lips and judge him for his sins. But the coal did not destroy Isaiah. Instead, it saved him. The king took away his guilt instead of bringing his destruction. And that is because of where the coal came from. It came from the altar where sins are atoned. It came from the place of sacrifice, where judgment brings hope, where forgiveness is offered, though punishment is owed. Isaiah's lips were made clean so that he might be a carrier of God's kingly decrees, which is why, after being saved by judgment, Isaiah says, "Here I am, send me." And the message this king would have Isaiah bring is that God, the highest king, was going to bring salvation by wielding against Israel his sword of judgment. God's people needed Isaiah's vision because they were truly untrusting. They were worshiping false idols, oppressing the poor, and making faithless alliances with pagan countries. And this faithlessness and idolatry is most clearly seen in Ahaz, the king, mentioned at the beginning of Isaiah's ministry. He received word that an attack was mounting against him and Jerusalem, and his heart shook within him. So, in fear, instead of trusting in God's protection, he would go and seek the help of the evil Assyrians. But God sent Isaiah with a word of correction. If Ahaz trusted God, the attack would stop. He needed to believe that God sat on the highest throne and could easily foil their enemies' plots. But Ahaz would not listen to Isaiah's words. Instead, he went to the Assyrians, paid them for military aid, and trusted in earthly kings instead of Ahaz's heavenly king who could actually save. So Ahaz would be betrayed. God, the highest king, would use the very rulers they trusted in to wield against them his sword of judgment. But God would provide another leader whom Isaiah predicted. A king called Emmanuel, who would be hailed as Wonderful Counselor and Prince of Peace. And it seemed Hezekiah, Ahaz's son, might be that king. For he tore down the idols and broke his father's evil treaty. But what would happen when news of the advancing Assyrian army once again reached the ear of the king? Would he, like his father, seek the assistance of a foreign country? Would he put his trust in an alliance with Egypt? Or would he listen to Isaiah's prophetic wisdom? As Isaiah told his father, so he now told his son. If he trusted God as king, their enemies would be undone. Well, Hezekiah listened to God's words and put his trust in the highest king. He would succeed where his father failed. So God's sword of judgment miraculously turned against the Assyrian army camped outside the heart of Israel. But soon after, Hezekiah's trust fell back upon earthly rulers when he was visited by messengers from the king of Babylon. He boasted in his riches, all of which were given to him. He gloried in his wealth instead of God, his king, who deserved the recognition. And so Isaiah told him that as God sent the Assyrians, he would also send the Babylonians. God, the highest king, would use the very rulers they trusted in to wield against them his sword of judgment. For her kings would continue to be evil. They would continue to worship idols, oppress the poor and the widows, and fail to trust that God would prevail over their rivals. So through Isaiah, God speaks of great destruction and trials. Babylon and her great army would have an inevitable arrival. The sword of the Lord would destroy Israel and take them into exile. The throne would be empty, the temple defiled. Yes, Israel would be punished. But with just as much assurance, God also promised to save his people through someone Isaiah called the servant. This is the same king spoken of to Ahaz and Hezekiah, the one who would be called Emmanuel, the one who would be God's Messiah. And the name we are given for this savior is Cyrus. This mighty Persian king whom Isaiah spoke of would bring Israel back into their land, for he would conquer Babylon and set them free. God would take the sword of judgment from Babylon and give it to Cyrus. God, the highest king, would defeat the very rulers they trusted in by wielding against them his sword of judgment. But Cyrus, like Hezekiah before, was not the ultimate fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecies about the servant of the Lord. Instead, Isaiah promised that God's final servant would save Israel in a way reminiscent of the coal placed on Isaiah's lips. As Isaiah was saved by the altar of sacrifice, so Israel would be saved through punishment. But unlike with the Assyrians and Babylonians, the sword of judgment would not come against them. Instead, God, the highest king, would use the very rulers they trusted in to wield against himself the sword of judgment. Jesus, the servant, would bear our transgressions. Jesus, the king, would take our afflictions. Upon Jesus, God would lay our iniquity. Upon Jesus would be our doom. For though we have gone astray, Jesus would heal us by his wounds. Isaiah's words end with a promise in view, that the king will bring his kingdom to earth, unmaking the old to build something new. The king, against whom all have rebelled, would come soon with his sword of judgment ready to use against the wicked, corrupt, and accused. But the good news is that Jesus, the suffering servant, is that coming king too. So if we trust the highest king like the rulers in Isaiah were supposed to do, if we trust that Jesus was struck though we should have been bruised, then like Isaiah's altar, we will be saved by what looks like destruction. So may Jesus, the highest King, be the only ruler we trust in, for he has and will save us by his sword, his cross of judgment.